الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين الذي هدانا لهذا وما كنا لنهتدي لولا أن هدانا الله والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين شفيع ذنوبنا وطبيب نفوسنا وحبيب قلوبنا أبي القاسم محمد وآله الطيبين الطاهرين المعصومين المظلومين وأصحابه المنتجبين ولعنة الله الدائمة على أعدائهم أجمعين بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقهوا قولي أما بعد السلام عليكم جميعا ورحمة الله وبركاته أعظم الله أجرنا وأجركم بمصاب نبي أبي عبد الله الحسين عليه الصلاة والسلام. The Who is Hussein campaign, actually the Birmingham branch of it is based at the Al-Mahdi Institute, and they are doing a phenomenal job. This is something that ought to be supported, and it's having a very positive impact on the community within London and Birmingham, within the UK and elsewhere in the world. Because when they receive these gestures, humanitarian gestures in the form of bottles or feeding the homeless, and they are actually prompted into asking, well, who is Hussein? And the message that is promoted is the humanitarian, universal values of Imam Hussein, and it is actually appealing to people because they associate with those humanitarian values that are depicted in Hussein, and to see the need for that in the present world of ours, and the hearts and mind are ripened and have come to that stage where they can accept universal human values beyond the designations of faith and are ready to acknowledge people who exemplify these values as the precursors of the spirit of humanity. So it's a very worthwhile campaign. We ought to support it wholeheartedly in the name of Hussein ibn Ali. Resuming our topic, and building from yesterday, we stated that this world of God is in a perpetual state of change, because motion brings about change. There is no stagnation, there is no permanence, save for change. Now, how odd is this? Human beings, psychologically, through their feeble human condition, find solace and comfort in permanence. However, there is no permanence. The only permanence is for change. The real objective of human being and attainment of purpose is to be able to become fluid, to be able to accept change, to embrace it, and always be in the state of becoming. No two instances of this world are the same. The Prophet of Islam, talking of spirituality of change, stated that he whose yesterday is the same as today, or he whose today is the same as yesterday, is a person who has been cheated. And he whose today is worse than his yesterday is a person who is mal'oon or cursed. Of course, la'na here means deprived of the mercy of God, which in other words means deprived of growth. 24 hours have elapsed, and this person has not evolved within those 24 hours. In fact, the whole art of purposeful existence is to embrace change and to change with this beautiful change. The Muslim mind needs to understand that its want to revert to a model that it feels was a divine model is a huge mistake. The model that was established and the fact that it worked for the time in which it worked was because it was a befitting model in accordance with the change that had occurred at that point. The ethos in that model was that it was depicting that particular state of human growth, and they were able to embrace that change. For us to want to go back to that model and to establish that model and not to take account of the change that has occurred since then is a failure. And in that way, we are no different from the people that the Quran rebukes at. When the Quran challenges the minds of the people to whom the Quran was given, they used to say, and Allah indeed quotes people of the Pharaoh, of Abraham, and before that the people of Nuh, and all of them, and their response was what? But this is not what our forefathers have done. Always this response has come back. That this is not what our forefathers have done. And Allah always undermines that argument by saying, well, what if their forefathers were not accurate in what they were doing? And He prompts them to think about this change that is a natural facet of existence, and it affects every area of human existence. Our personal existence, our domestic existence, our social existence. There is no stagnation, everything is moving. And the absolute state of existence, a purposeful life, and the art of living a purposeful life is to be open to change and to become fluid with this change, to embrace this change and to change with change. There are no two states that are the same in this world. The only thing that seeks permanence is the feeble mind. Now, let's work into this, that this change we described yesterday is an evolutionary change. It is always building on former achievement. What a great loss that the Muslim mind, through its wishful thinking, wants to get stuck 1,400 years ago and fails to embrace the evolutionary change that has taken place for the last 1,400 years. It has lost out on such great opportunities, such great beauty. If you look at the community of the Prophet, these were communities that had audacity. They were confident of themselves. They were not afraid to experiment. They were not afraid to try. The whole purpose of the occultation of Sahib al-Zaman alayhi salatu wasalam has been so that the human mind can experience life firsthand and learn from their experiences through trials and errors. How else are we supposed to arrive at an accurate model of life if it was not for physical trials and errors? But the Muslim mind right now is not the same as the one created by the Prophet. The one created by the Prophet was in sync with change and evolution. They were not afraid of trying things out, experimenting things. They were not afraid of falling and failures because they knew what the Prophet had supplied them with. Unlike the modern mind that is afraid of failure, that is afraid of sinning, that is afraid of inaccuracy, whilst not knowing that sin is a part and parcel of human existence, it is there. I'm talking about sin in the broadest manner, yes? In the broadest manner, that mistakes, slipping, is actually an agency of growth. Look at today. I want to discuss this at length, slowly, gradually. Look at today. Have you noticed the Muslim tendency of doing istikhara? Why does the Muslim do istikhara? Because they don't want the onus of taking a decision. Now, if God has said this, then even if it is bad, I will do it. What if the Maulana doesn't know what istikhara is all about? Isn't this just complacency in failure? We are taking solace in negative theology. By negative theology, I'm not talking about negative theology of God, which is quite remarkable. Ali ibn Abi Talib talks about it in the first khutbah, negative theology. I'm talking about negative theology as in unbefitting theology. They take solace and comfort in negative theology to justify their despicable state of human existence and become complacent therein. If I am not rich, God has destined this for me. If I'm met with failures, then I'm meant to be a failure, not seeing that the failure is an opportunity for a greater success. It is totally failed in understanding what was going on in the time of the Prophet and what ought to be going on right now. The Prophet filled his community with such audacity, such confidence. It brought them in line with the principles of existence, of change and evolution. There are a few points we need to discuss in the next few days, and I'll try to get through them as quickly as possible. The Prophet said, when you do something, do istikhara. But what was Prophet's istikhara? The Prophet said, seek khair from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Seek the best from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Put your right foot, best foot forward and do it. You can never fail. even if you fail by worldly terms, because your intention was pure and sincere, you can never be a failure. Your failure will translate itself into success. That's how he filled his community with audacity and confidence. Nobody was afraid of trying things out. The governance that took place of the state, they did not have a clue of a model of governance. As the Islamic Empire was advancing and expanding, they were benefiting from the Romans, from the Persians, from other empires, from their learning of governance, from their understanding of economics, so on and so forth. Look at the example of these great people in the initial part, in the formative part of Islam, and look at the examples from the lives of the Imams. They were audacious, they were bold, they did not hesitate to try out things. Why? Because they had this understanding that no matter what we do, our failures will result into success, because overall we are growing. We are becoming more and more competent, and that's how we are supposed to be. So the istikhara that the Prophet taught was this confidence in human ability by attaching it with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in a very sincere way. This is how the Prophet taught them. Is it any wonder that within no time whatsoever, the people who were involved with camels fighting each other, killing each other, in immoralities, in burying their daughters, within no time whatsoever, they contribute to what we call civilization. They moved the human society forward in a meaningful way, and hence they are the contributors to human civilization. From where to where? From people of dust, from people who worship numerous gods, from people who lack total confidence, to the fathers of the modern scientific methodology. From people stuck in that sandy land to the explorers. From people who did not know beyond fighting to people who are now morally displaying the gems of humanity. From people who did not venture beyond their lands to people who are now bringing in the people who could not read or write, to people now, through conquest of Athens and other places, are importing Greek learning from the Romans into Islam, translating it, developing it, and evolving it to the extent that West takes again from Islam, from that position that the Prophet created, to this present state of crisis. They embraced change meaningfully. They understood the meaning of change at the human, individual, psychological level, and at the level of a community. And look at the broadness that the Prophet gave to them. Today, America is successful because it should be successful. It has that attitude of success. Islam once had that. Do you know this? Today, if you look at America, it has very broad parameter. It does not have a very restrictive identity. It allows itself to regain its identity at every moment. It can gain identity from time to time and reformulate itself. Not that it is stuck with an identity. This is exactly the case that was with Islam. Islam did not have a fixed identity that made it restrictive. It was a flowing religion. Its parameters were flexible. Any culture was absorbed into the Islamic culture. There was a universality of the identity of an ummah. And in that, there was scope that different cultures could be absorbed and add to the overall beauty. It had that charm at one point. And now it's become restrictive and exclusivist. Whereas before, it saw itself, based upon its theology, based upon the teaching of the Prophet, as a human reality, not as an imposition from the heavens upon man. This is the shift that has been made from the time of the Prophet till now. Now, whatever the physical factors that might have been that have contributed to this is another point. I'm addressing and trying to address the present crisis that we have. When we talk of Mahdiism, similarly, there's a crisis. Now, think about this carefully. I've been beating on this for the last few days, that when a child takes birth and the child is being fed with this notion that the world is a world that is unworthy of being lived in. There is nothing good in this world. And eventually, an imam will come and kill the majority of this world, and you will have a good world to live in before you die. If that child is being fed with these notions, what would the attitude of that child be to the contemporary world of his when he grows up and lives therein? It would be a world of contempt. This is what has happened to me and you. Our world has become a contemptible world. It's a wrong world in which we live. The physical world in which we are is an inviting place. It's a place of opportunities. It's a place of growth. It's a place of beauty. It's a place of charm. It's a place where we can make something out of our humanity. But the mental worlds imposed within our mind that are then shaping and discoloring the real world are spoiling the whole experience of life. Today's Muslim, the child is being taught that you can't make a mistake. God wants you to do this in this precise manner, to the extent that the child is frightened out of his wits that when they do wudu in a wrong way, they're going to go to hell. Please be honest, isn't this me and you? Haven't we been brought up in the same cradle and in the same lap that I'm describing right now? Isn't this our world? Isn't this our Islam? That everything else is despicable, horrible, ungodly. What we have is the best that we are supposed to have, but we don't have it because the last one will come and provide it for us. We don't have to do anything. Hasn't this totally ruined our experience of life? This is the movement away from the truth of humanity. And because of this weakness in our minds, every positive notion that was supplied by Islam has been interpreted in a very negative way. And that negativity prompts and breeds more negativity. Imagine, we all say this, but do we truly understand what it means? That if you have a positive attitude, the world tends to you in a very positive way. If you're happy, the world is happy with you. If you frown, you will only frown more. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, "Man jaa bil hasana falahu khairun minha." He who comes with something good, he has abundance good. The world reciprocates in a good way. If you do something positive, the world adds to that positivity in a meaningful way. But when you're negative, you become negative within yourself. This is what the Quran states. We say this. We read this. But do we ever question our attitudes? Today we have all these tests that they conduct, that your attitude towards food affects the food and the quality of the food that you cook. If a woman is cooking a food, incidentally, did you see how I'm conditioned? I said, if a woman cooks food. Although the best chefs in the world are men, I think. But I'd still prefer the women to cook food, yes? If a woman cooks food, I think I'm going to stick with my traditional biases here. I like the cooking of women, so please carry on cooking. When a woman cooks food and she has had a bad argument with her husband, you see, I didn't say children, husband, then that food becomes disoriented within itself. And when we eat it, it actually affects us negatively. So if that's the case with the physical world, then what about the real world? If two, how many billion are we now? 3 billion? No, Muslims. 2 billion? If 2 billion people are spewing out negativity, the world becomes a blackened place. If these 2 billion people project godliness and positivity, the whole world begins to sing and dance with it. Not the haram type of singing and dancing, of course. Yes, I need to qualify myself at every instance now. I don't know why. But bring in references as well afterwards. That singing and dancing of the world is a very different singing and dancing anyway. This negativity that is within us is wholly unnatural. It's a product of whatever has happened to the Muslims. But the Muslims need to understand and to see that change is a natural facet of the world. There will be nothing that remains the same. No social system, no political system, no economical system, no moral system. Of course, the principles are the same. No spiritual system and no legal system should remain the same.
every single thing will go through mutation, through the changing of the world.
But this changing is a phenomenal changing. It's a beautiful change. It's a change that is progressive. It's an evolutionary change. What we mean by evolutionary change is that it builds upon its own strength. And this is the way we have observed the prophetic trend. This is the way we have observed the miracles. This is the way we have observed the reformulations of Sharia and its sophistication from era to era. It is the same as a child stepping outside the cradle, crawling, then walking, then running, then talking, then feeling, then thinking, and then contributing. It's the same trend that a tree takes from a seed that sprouts, that builds a bark, then gives branches, then leaves, then fruits. It's the same change. It's a beautiful evolutionary change. Now, what happens in this change? In this evolutionary change, what happens is that incompetency is replaced by competency. It's something very natural. Our reliance on the other diminishes and a different type of need arises. This is how it's supposed to be. And in that process, there is that God-given right to make mistakes. But if those mistakes are made sincerely, then those mistakes are divine and godly. Now, when somebody asks me, what is the model of governance that is Islamic? I will say simply, whichever model works. There is no more Islamic to it than that. You see, one of the things that's been hijacked is this title Islamic. When they say Islamic philosophy, I quickly say actually it's Muslim philosophy, meaning these are the contributions of Muslim minds influenced by the text of Islam. Don't give it that designation Islamic philosophy, because when you say Islamic philosophy, sometimes, somehow, in the minds of people, it becomes ordained by God. It's not ordained by God in that way. It is accurate for so long as it is accurate. But as change takes place and growth takes place, it will soon have to be replaced by something else. Similarly, any social system, it is accurate to the extent that it works based on principles of fairness and justice. But it cannot be a model that sustains humanity throughout its evolution and growth. That is nonsensical. Tell me, a child in kindergarten studies a text. That text can never, ever sustain the intellectual growth of that child beyond that point. The text will have to be replaced. But the same 1 plus 1 equals 2 will consistently be true. But the 1 plus 1, the numerical values, will acquire different formulations at every stage of that child's intellectual growth. Until the child becomes a young man, graduates, and as a philosopher, he will say whether the numerical one is a number or not. This is the profound level to which the child will reach. So if a textbook supplying the intellectual demand of a child has to change with the growth of the child, then why by priority should anything else remain the same? Today, in the present world, with international democracies, we are talking about the global village. It's a world whose demands are far different to the world of the past. It's a very different world. The world of transactions and commerce today is a very different world. It doesn't have a model in the past. How will we, by examples of the past, resolve today's modern challenges? Surely there should be evolution in the commerce, banking systems, in economics, in our way we think about finances, in the way we think about a fair and a just economy. We can't be so foolish as to think that a model has been created 1,400 years ago and that can be applied today. In fact, the model created 1,400 years ago was based on the principles of the Quran, but that model was not spelled out in the Quran. It was a model of trial and error in itself. But they had the confidence in their humanity, in their intelligence,
And the Prophet condoned that confidence. And the Prophet promoted that confidence. This is what we are talking about, the living Mahdiism. The Mahdi that is going to come at a very progressed level. That there is change. This change is evolutionary. Everything needs to change. The problem, however, with the Muslim mind is that the Muslim mind has become dormant. Why? It's not the fault of the Muslim mind. It is because of this fear that I will do something contrary to what God wants me to do. So there is a problem at a theological level, that God expects me to do something precisely. I will say this much. Oh my Lord, if you really and truly wanted me to do something very, very precisely, then why did you have this flame of inquiry? Why did you kindle this flame of inquiry deep within my heart? You are not letting me rest. You are depriving me my peaceful sleep at night. Because on the one hand, you want me to follow a model you have created. And on the other hand, you've given me this evolution. And then you're making me an inquisitive person asking why, and this does not make sense. Why should I do something that doesn't make sense? Can you see that? I'll give an example. But these examples are to be seen as examples only, not as points of references nor criticism. Yes? I'll see it. When we give homes, for example, I'm just picking on a petty example because I want to go into something quite different. When we give homes, we are told, give qurbatan ilallahi ta'ala. Yes? Now, tell me, what purpose does that serve? It doesn't serve any purpose. Homes, if you look at the time and the era of the Prophet, served a meaningful purpose of governing the state. It was a state tax. Zakat was a welfare tax. We know this by reading the Quran, by looking at the attitude of the Prophet and the conduct of the Prophet. Here, why should my mind be so dormant in thinking that I have to give this amount of money to X, Y, and Z person with the intention of qurbatan Allah, otherwise Allah will beat me up? Why shouldn't my mind be able to think that it served a purpose? And it was a purposeful entity. It was a purposeful, meaningful law within the Quran. And why should I even think this way, that zakat, just because I don't have crop and I don't have livestock, that there is no need in a state for welfare needs of the people? People are poor, people are hungry. People need education. Of course, there ought to be a welfare tax. Today in America, you have welfare tax, don't you? You have state tax, don't you? You're all paying it, aren't you? How different is zakat and khums from that? Why is it that this notion of spirituality attached with khums is blurring the whole notion of a very meaningful thing that was there within the governance of a state has been skewed up in the minds? Isn't it only due to this notion of fear of God, that God wants me to do something very, very precisely, and if I do it otherwise, I'll be wrong? When Husayn ibn Ali was asked to give bay'ah to Yazid, he very strongly responded. He said, لَقَدْ تَرَكَنِي أَدْعَيَّ ابْنُ الدَّعِي. A false claimant, a son of false claimant, has left me between two choices, سِلَّ وَدِلَّ, either having myself beheaded or belittled. And then he responds, Hayhat lana dhalik. Far removed from us is humility. Ya'aballah lana dhalik wa rasuluhu wal mu'minun. Allah does not allow us that. Nor does his messenger, nor do the people. Look at the three-way responsibility he establishes here. That he's responsible to Allah, he's responsible to the messenger of Allah, and he's responsible to the people themselves. When the Imam says he's responsible and accountable to the people, anybody less than the Imam would not be responsible and accountable to the people? Does the mind truly accept that? Now, if you've got that example, let us go on. We are extremely afraid of making mistakes. We are petrified of making mistakes. What if I do this with my homes? Allah will grab me and punish me. I will say this with taking full ownership of my statements. By Allah, on the day of Qiyamah, the Messenger of God will ask us, as Amirul Mu'mineen says, why did you squander the wealth of the poor when you knew that the people you're giving it to, they might be very pious people, but they don't have a sense of business and commerce. They don't know what to do with it. There was no accountability for it. Why did you do this with the wealth of God and the poor people? Surely you should be more responsible. But mine and your attitude is, I need to shift this burden of responsibility and place it upon the other. Can you ever shift the burden of responsibility and place it upon the other? Is it even possible? Tell me something. Will Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept from me as a Muslim when I say that I did this and this and this? And Allah said, it doesn't make sense to you. It didn't make sense to you as a community. Why did you do it? Will that excuse ever work? As I said, I don't mean to take a dig at anybody. These are examples in which we need to work through them. The thing is, we are extremely afraid to take ownership of our actions. Istikhara is one example. The other example is nothing in the life of the Shia Muslim is the responsibility of the Shia Muslim. These are sheep and they want to remain as sheep. They don't want to awaken. It's amazing. I have not seen a community that has produced doctors, accountants, physicians, astronomers, and yet their minds are dormant and don't work. It's amazing. It's truly amazing. Why don't the people awaken? Is there any lack of education? No, there's full education. Is there any lack of exploring the world? They've explored the world. Then why are they stuck? Spiritually, psychologically, philosophically, why don't they open their minds? It's squarely based on this. A very false sense of understanding the world and theology that God demands from me that I ought to be like this. Now, I'll ask you a question. You see, mine and your idea of success is that I pray my namaz, I do my fast, whether they're 24-hour fast, I'll do a 24-hour. How nonsensical is this, by the way? A student of mine sat on a plane from Sweden, flying towards America, and you know the sun never sets. The poor fellow, in August, sat on a plane in Sweden, was going to Canada via America, ended up fasting 27 hours because the sun would never set. Truly, is this what was required? Surely, is this what was required? That the sunrise and sunset, and then if I go to space, there is no sunrise and sunset. What will happen then? There is no fast? There is no Kaaba, so there is no prayer? Is this what our thinking is, truly? I'm asking. The problem with me and you is, we are in a very false world. Very false world. It's a wrong world. The true world is the world that is happening now. Now, let's talk about this false world and think about it. We think we will attain salvation when the 12th Imam comes and we will go into paradise. How foolish can we be? Paradise is all about graduation. Can somebody who is the owner of a corporation give somebody a job who is not qualified to carry out the task? Can an instructor graduate a student who does not have the learning? Can God give paradise to somebody who has not matured and come of age fully intellectually and spiritually? What sort of a world are we living in? What salvation will the 12th Imam give to us? We are babies. You know what his greatest point of lamentation is? And his greatest grief? That these children are not growing up. It is only when they grow up that I can come. But they are not ready to graduate in their false imaginative worlds. Now, what was meant to happen was that we were supposed to take the stakeholding of our life, full ownership of our life. There is no more prophet who is going to come. There are no more imams that are going to come. The 12th Imam cannot come because we are in this state. If we take the stakeholding of our lives, full ownership, full responsibility, and embark on the evolutionary path, then there is a chance. Then there is a chance that he will appear. What does that mean? What that means is that we fall back in line with evolution and growth, bearing responsibility of our actions. Today's Shia Muslim is wholly
formed around somebody else taking decisions for him. And he has no part in decision making. Today, in the UK, for the most mundane things, the Maulanas are referred to give a religious opinion. And the people don't have the confidence in them to take a decision. From career choices to how to resolve a dispute within domestic capacity. Father and son have a dispute. The Maulana is asked, what is the fatwa to resolve this dispute? Yes? And this is the truth that we are living there now. Career choices. Can we choose this career? Can we choose? It's wholly ridiculous to say, can we actually study law? Can we actually participate in the judicial system of the country? Can we become medical doctors? Why? Because we will be called upon at times to practice forms of what is considered passive euthanasia. Can we become medics when we are called upon to advise for abortions? These questions should not have arisen at all. It is because we have not fallen in line with that evolution and progression and growth. We do not want to take responsibility for our actions. It's a lazy community, not because they want to be lazy, but because it has fallen into this wishful thinking and a very false outlook. They look 1400 years ago to a model and they don't appreciate that model for what it was, in principle, in essence. And then they project this model to the present, and the future is that only this is the right model, and the great Imam will come and destroy every other model that is there. There is nothing more nonsensical than this. The whole idea was for us to flow, to grow from weakness into strength, to lessen our reliance and dependence upon the other, and take ownership of our lives and bear the responsibility for the mistakes that we make and build upon them. That was supposed to be the charm of life, and that is what Islam is all about, the living Islam, and Mahdiism is all about, and that's when Mahdi will come. Now, think about it in this way. There's a community of business-minded people. These people were supposed to think about the poor and the welfare of the poor. They were supposed to think about the future of this community in America and globally. They were supposed to think 20, 50, 100 years ahead and see where the community ought to be. This community was, I'm not talking about this present community, I'm talking about our communities generically. Community was supposed to understand that we need to be involved in politics at every level of society in order to establish ourselves and in order to meaningfully contribute. But instead, the community doesn't do any such thing, fearing that it might all be wrong, and the decisions are never taken by the community. These brilliant business-minded people, if they had understood the meaning of khums, for example, then they would have established international financial institutions. Tell me, is this logic or not? That today, I keep on giving £1,000 to somebody every week or every month and they keep on spending it. As a businessman, I would think, let me invest this money or embark on the path of microfinancing so this person can become empowered, can become needless, and as opposed to consuming the funds, can contribute. Wouldn't that be my thinking? Let me invest this fund so that these funds can generate more funds, and as opposed to feeding 1,000 mouths, I can feed 10,000 mouths without reducing the capital. Shouldn't this be something that a state should be doing? Wouldn't any state do this? Then why is this revenue being squandered to this extent, without a sense of accountability and without a sense of responsibility by the community itself? If the community was on an evolutionary track, they would be fully responsible towards God and His Prophet. Amir al-Mu'mineen said this in his Najul Balagha. Salamullah alayhi said, I would much rather stand bare feet upon thorns all night long, and be dragged and chained upon my face, than to appear before Allah and the Habib of Allah on the day of Qiyamah in a way that I carry the burden of responsibility against any of their creatures. Shouldn't the community as a collective body be thinking in a way that they are responsible? They are responsible for their own welfare, the welfare of others around them, and a meaningful existence of this community, of a Muslim community, within what we have been calling so far the non-Muslim host community. Of course, it's not the host community, and we're not the guest community, but these are the sort of titles we use because our minds are still not here. Our bodies are here. We've spent 40 years here, but we still call the other community the host community. This should not be the attitude. The reliance upon other should diminish with evolution and growth. The reliance upon other is of variety of types. Individual reliance, communal reliance. The whole surge forward in an evolutionary manner is that we become more and more competent. And as we become more and more competent at an individual level, we take responsibility for our individual selves. As a community, we take responsibility for the community and we arrive at a level of competency. And as we arrive at a level of competency, other areas of need will manifest themselves. And we have to all contribute to that. The model in our minds is that the Prophet was the guide. The 12th Imam was the guide. And in the absence of the 12th Imam, there has to be a single individual who is the guide. I'm going to give an example that I gave a few days ago. I'm going to repeat it once again. In Tehran, at Shahid Beheshti University, now there were Ayatollahs there as well giving their papers, yes? As a part of Al-Mahdi Institute, I gave my paper on what my thoughts were about euthanasia. And I concluded there what my thoughts were about euthanasia. Some people spoke on economic lines, some on philosophical lines. Mine was philosophical, spiritual, and legal, all intertwined. And I stated, so long as there is passive potentiality, we cannot pull the plug. Yes, basically, in very crude terms. I was called. I went back to the UK, and I was called into the hospital. There was a little young child, and she was on full life support system. The doctors were pushing for the life support to be taken back, removed. And the mother was beside herself and the father. And she said to me, she said, but if we were to keep the life support, God can do anything. He can save her. And if we were to remove it, we would do something wrong. The doctors said, this is undignified. We can't allow her to be in this way. His own argument was flawed as well. But the problem was, in my mind, a theological problem. If we were to remove the life support, it would result in unbearable grief and guilt in the mind of the mother. That we have done something wrong theologically. Can you see that? If we kept the life support and extended her life, then the image of that young child suffering for days on end would result in further grief and guilt when we find out that it wasn't necessary theologically. So it's a double-edged sword. That was my dilemma. So I spoke with the doctor and said, look, saving a life is your opinion. My opinion was obviously, so long as there is passive potential of reason, you have to keep the life sustained. He said, according to your thoughts, he challenged me. He said, I need to put my hand inside her heart and physically keep on pumping it. How far do I go? And that posed a severe challenge. And for the first time I understood that we don't know what we are talking about. When we theorize based on Islamic text, we really don't know what we are going on about. Our world of theory based on Islamic text and the real world that is out there are two different worlds altogether. We need to open our eyes. I said, let me have an hour. Within the hour, the child died, and I thanked Allah that I did not have to make that decision. Yes? Now, it was this thing that made me finally understand and open my eyes. that actually the responsibility of taking such decisions is not upon a single individual who is deprived of that learning and context. The learning of the medics, the learning of philosophers, ethicians, the care people, all of their learning, which is the community learning, has to be integrated, and everybody has to take the burden and ownership of that decision, whether right or wrong, and that is the only way forward. And that is going from incompetency to competency. And needs change. Similarly, in business and commerce, the community minds, the brilliance that community has, the businessmen, the bankers, the economists, they have to apply their minds in a collective way to give those decisions. It's not the role of somebody who is detached from the context and the situation. It's the collective learning that has to come together and has to provide answers. This is what we mean by evolution. To take ownership of our decisions. And if it's wrong, then to rectify it, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala honors this. The whole trend of evolution is one of going from incompetency into competency. This, if we can imbibe that within us, it's a very audacious move, then the community will not be this stagnant and will not suffer in the way that it is suffering. Now, I'm just going to point out one or two sort of positive aspects of this type of understanding. When a child goes to madrasa and madrasa education is opposed to having this sharp distinction of Muslim and non-Muslim, there would be an open understanding of good and evil generally, as opposed to having this understanding that's drilled into their minds of the negativity of the future. A very positive attitude would be imparted to them, in which they will grow positively, as opposed to them becoming medical doctors and accountants. They might think of becoming politicians, astronauts, artists, contributing in a meaningful way to the welfare of the world and the community at large. This is what this positive surge forward and falling in line with evolution will do for us, if we have that confidence to do it. And negativity and a bleak outlook would not govern us in the way that it is governing us. The people with Hussein ibn Ali salamullah alayhi, these were the people who are people that were living souls, that were not dead. When we talk about their sacrifice, it wasn't a simple issue of them going and dying. These people had those living souls. Otherwise, 72 people cannot impact the history of mankind. There was a caliber inside there. There was a substance in them which has generated this passion within the universe, within the mankind. These were souls that were living souls. These were not frightened people, not insecure people. These were people that knew what they were doing. Now, I've given this example before. There is Hur in the camp of Hussein. Hur is a person who is responsible for bringing Imam Hussein into that wilderness, is he or is he not? Yet he attains a lofty status and a rank. He has never prayed behind Imam Hussein a single prayer acknowledging Imam Hussein as the Imam. En route to Kufa, he prayed behind Imam Hussein, but not as an Imam, because he objected to the Imam and he intercepted his path audaciously. And then there is another person in the camp of Imam Hussein, Wahab. He's a Christian. He doesn't understand the meaning of imamat. He doesn't even understand prophethood. He probably doesn't even know what Quran is. He doesn't even know what it means to be a Muslim and Muslim theology. You saw how this man and his mother came to the Prophet, and how this man gives his sacrifice. They join Imam Hussein on the morning of Ashura. He attains his sacrifice, and today he is amongst those 72 or 150 people that are
floating and hovering around the arsh of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
He is not a Muslim in the way that me and you understand Islam. He doesn't even understand Islam in the way me and you understand Islam. Yet, look at where he is. Because of that glorious soul of his, which was a living soul, full of confidence. He knew what he was doing, whether in the name of Christianity, Islam, whatever the designation, he knew that this man is worthy of defending. He knew that accurately, and he has attained his lofty rank through that truth that he imbibed within himself. These were the people in Karbala, and that is what gives Karbala its charm. Amongst the sons of Imam Hassan, there were 4 to 5 sons of Imam Hassan in Karbala. Save one, all the rest of them, they met with Shahada and martyrdom. Hassan Musanna was presumed dead as he fell off his steed and was struck, wounded, he lost consciousness. They presumed that he was dead, but when they went to cut his head off, they saw slight movement in him. And somebody from the clan, from the army of Yazid, was related to Hassan Musanna. And he went to Ibn Sa'd and he said, he is related to me, spare him, let me nurse him. After a few days, he regained consciousness and he said, where is Hussein? And when he was told Hussein is killed, he was filled with grief, but he is the only one who lived through the incident of Karbala. The rest of the sons of Imam Hassan were killed. Now to narrate 2 incidences. In the Maqatil we find that Imam Hussein would go to his battlefield after losing Askar, would go to the battlefield, and after some time would come back to his tent and cry out, La hawla wa la quwwata illa billah. The reason why he would do this, the Maqatil tell us, is that his sister's heart would be filled with anxiety, being mindful that Zainab is filled with anxiety, he would come back to the tents and cry out, La hawla wa la quwwata illa billah, so Zainab knows that her brother is still alive. He did this on 3 occasions. On the 3rd occasion, when he comes back to the tent, the enemies surround him. Hussein falls to the ground and he is defending himself. The cloth of the curtain lifts slightly. An 11-year-old boy comes out of the tent. This is the son of Imam Hassan, the last son of Imam Hassan. He looks at Hussein and he cries out, why are you killing my uncle? Hussein looks at the son of Imam Hassan and sees him running towards Imam Hussein and sees Zainab appear behind him. And he calls out, Ya Zainab, ihbasihi. O Zainab, grab the child. Zainab runs behind the child, but is unable to grab the child. The child runs to Imam Hussein, and as somebody is about to strike Hussein ibn Ali, the child stretches out his hand, and the hand is cut from the elbow. The child cries in pain, O uncle, they have severed my arm. Imam Hussein grabs him as Imam Hussein has fallen and places him to his chest and grabs him tightly. As he grabs him tightly, an arrow is shot towards Hussein. The arrow penetrates into the chest of this young child and into Imam Hussein. And Hussein cries out aloud and says, O child, like this shall we be raised in front of Allah and in front of your father. This was the last son of Al-Hassan. On the night of Ashura, Imam Hussein examines his band and their loyalty at the insistence of Lady Zainab. Oh brother, I fear for tomorrow. Examine them good today so that they may remain steadfast tomorrow. Hussein is filled with joy and says, my God, no prophet, no wali before me has been blessed with such honorable souls. Imam Hussein says, no, for tomorrow, that all of you without fail shall be executed and killed. Qasim, who is still at a tender age, comes to his uncle and says, "Oh, uncle, am I too going to taste martyrdom tomorrow?" Hussein looks at this young child and says, "Oh, Qasim, what do you understand of death?" He said, "Oh, uncle, if it is for you, then it is sweeter than the sweetest honey." He embraces Qasim and he says, "Oh, Qasim, indeed you shall taste death as with my child Abdullah, Asghar shall taste death." He said, "Shall they walk into the tents, oh uncle?" He said, "No, child, I shall take him out to be quenched." The day of Ashura comes. The mutual combat ends. The single combat begins. Akbar is being martyred. When many of Abbas's brothers fall, and Qasim's brothers fall, Qasim's mother spurs him on. She says, "Oh child, go to your uncle. Even though you are tender of age, I would like you to defend your uncle." When Qasim comes to Hussein, this is the description. Hussein turns his face away. Qasim runs to him from the other side. His eyes are filled with tears. And he says, "Oh child, I beseech you for the sake of Allah, ask me not." Qasim returns to the tent and says to his mother, "My uncle hesitates. Say to your uncle, oh child, that it is my wish, your mother, that you should go and defend your uncle." Qasim comes to Hussein and conveys this. This is the way the Maqtal describes. Hussein places Qasim upon the horse. His age is so tender that Qasim's feet do not reach the stirrup of the horse. Hamid ibn Muslim describes that his sandal strap was broken and one of his sandal was dangling upon his foot. Hussein cuts his amama in two, and we know it was a black amama from the way it's described. He places one part of the amama on the shoulders and the chest and back of Qasim. And the other part of the amama he places upon the head of the Qasim and brings its tail from the face of Qasim. Now the reason why I say this is that Qasim's tender age did not allow him to wear the coat of armor and the coat of mail. The reason why I say this is when Qasim comes to the battlefield, Hamid ibn Muslim describes, it was like the first moon appearing from behind black clouds. Only a portion of his face was available for us to see from beneath the black amama of Hussein that he had placed upon his face. Hussein stood upon a hill with Abbas, looking at Qasim. Umar ibn Sa'd saw Qasim come into the battlefield for single combat. He said to Azraq, a renowned warrior, "Go and finish the child." He said, "Sorrow be my lot, Umar ibn Sa'd. What cause do I have to fight with children? My son is sufficient for him." He sends his son. When Hussein's eyes fall upon the son of Azraq, inadvertently, he raises his hands to the sky. "Oh Lord, my Qasim is a child. He is hungry, he is thirsty. Oh Lord, grant my Qasim victory upon this warrior." Qasim puts him to death. Abbas instructs Qasim in warfare. Azraq sends another one of his sons. Qasim puts him to death. A third son, Qasim puts him to death. A fourth son, Qasim puts him to death. When four sons of Azraq were killed, in a rage he entered the battlefield. As Hussein saw him, he pleaded, "Oh Lord, this is Azraq. My Qasim is but a child. Oh Lord, grant him victory over Azraq. And I promise you,
I will bring back the severed body of my Qasim back to the tents. As Azraq appears within the battlefield, Qasim puts him to death. As he puts him to death, Amr ibn Sa'd shouts, "Await not! Surround him and finish him off." Qasim is surrounded from all directions. As he fights, Hussein cannot see what is happening. He calls out, "O Qasim, call to me, call to me." In the midst of the battle, he hears a cry, "O uncle, come to my aid." Hussein realizes Qasim has fallen from his steed. The description states, like a raging lion, Hussein descends from the top of the hill into the battlefield as the enemies are about to tear Qasim into pieces. As Hussein advances, the enemies break. As they scatter, Hussein can hear the cries and the pleas of Qasim. "Oh, uncle, come to me." Hamid ibn Muslim says, "There was so much dust raised from the commotion that I could not see anything. The only thing was, I could hear the cries of Hussein filling the air of Karbala, the sort of cries that I had not heard from Hussein on the day of Ashura. When the dust settled, I saw that Hussein has placed his cheek upon the wounded chest of Qasim, and he is calling out, 'O child, it is unbearable for your uncle to not to be able to come to you when you call out to him and not to come to your assistance.'" I observed, Hamid ibn Muslim says, Qasim rubbed his heels upon the plains of Karbala and breathed his last. Hussein cried out aloud for a while and did not move. Then I saw Hussein grabbed the body of Qasim, but it was torn and mutilated to an extent that Qasim's chest was within the arms of Hussein. And as he made his return, Qasim's feet were dragging upon the dust of Karbala. Hussein brings Qasim back to the tents and places him next to the body of Akbar, and then sits between the two bodies, takes off his helmet, places dust upon his head, places his right hand on the chest of Akbar, left hand on the chest of Qasim, looks towards the sky and cries out, "O Lord, Hussein has been deprived of his sons." Martin Hussein.